Hello, if you're new here, my name is Shelly, and if you like all things true crime, conspiracy, and serial killers, and you also like makeup, then definitely stick around because you might enjoy this. I don't know. I'm not sure if I want to go like crazy with my makeup today because I do have somewhere that I need to go. Screw it. Now I'm gonna try to sit more off to the side because I feel like in editing, whenever I try to put pictures onto the thing, I either want to like just cover the whole screen and cover everything, or I want to be able to have an area to put pictures off to the side. So if I'm off center, that's why. Now today we're going to be talking about Mary Flora Bell, the 10-year-old psychopath. So if you're wanting to learn more about her, then keep on watching. So Mary Flora Bell was born May 26, 1957 in Newcastle, England. Now, she had a rough childhood, okay? Her mom was a sex worker and, you know, I mean, I don't judge anyone for what their profession is or anything, but that can be really hard on a child, and especially when you hear what I have to tell you in a second. So she wasn't married, she was 17 years old. And this is Mary's mother, Betty. Betty, when she had Mary, it said that whenever the nurse put her in her arms, she said, "You take this away from me." Like from the very beginning, she did not want anything to do with Mary, but she kind of had to take care of her. She tried to pawn her off on several family members, but her family members would just say, "No, she's your kid. You need to take care of her." She was also known for throwing Mary out a second story window when she was little. Obviously, Mary survived, but that's still super terrible and traumatic for a child. Betty was very bipolar. She even took Mary to an abortion clinic and tried to give her to a random lady there. Also, if you're going to an abortion clinic to pawn off your child, that is the last place to go. So for the most part, Betty worked out of her own home. She would often make trips to Scotland, and when she did this, she would be gone for weeks at a time. And at home, Mary just never felt loved. She was never showed love at all. And one terrible, terrible part of this story is that her mother, Betty, actually prostituted her at 6 years old to pedophiles. Now, no one ever got like a for sure answer on who Mary's father was. Mary did end up marrying a man named Billy Bell, but a lot of people don't think that this man was for sure Mary's father. A lot of people think that Mary was born of incest by her grandfather. A lot of people think that why Betty hated Mary so much was because her grandfather had actually been the father of the child, and that is just a horrible situation. Another time, there were witnesses that said that Mary went up to Betty asking for some candy or something, and Betty actually gave her some pills or whatever she had in her purse, and they were sleeping pills. Because there were witnesses to this, later she told people that she had accidentally mixed up the tablets and gave her her sleeping pills instead of candy, which most people don't think that was an accident at all. And apparently Mary got really sick for a while from it. So Mary's family lived in a town called Scotswood, And this little town was small, and they were still recovering from the war. All of the families there were very poor. The city was very dirty, and it was just a very poor city. And Mary's family, they didn't even have furniture. They didn't really have money for food. She just lived a very poor lifestyle. And all of the kids from this city would all play outside unsupervised, and they would always be unsupervised, usually until late at night, because most of these kids' mothers did what Mary's mother did, and they were prostitutes or ladies of the night, and they would be out late. And so all of these kids were unsupervised, out playing constantly. None of their parents really kept like strict tabs on where they were all the time. Everyone was just kind of used to several kids being out about in the street unsupervised all the time. Growing up, Mary was known to have a very quick temper. At age 8 or 9, a lot of people kind of just knew her by this reputation. A lot of the little girls that she played with would run from her, and they were terrified of her. Because of her quick temper, she would get so mad that she would shake and her eyes would get big, and to a little kid, that would be scary. One minute you're playing with your friend and everything's fine, and then the next minute they're like shaking and getting red and super mad. Some of her classmates recalled her saying how she wanted to hurt people, or that she liked to hurt people. One day she was even strangling one of the little girls at the park or wherever, and an older kid had to come and separate them. The kids told on her and said that she had put cigarettes out on their cheeks. So these kids were unsupervised for the most part, and if they were at school and any of this happened, the teachers wouldn't really do much. Now, Mary had a best friend whose name was Norma Bell, and they weren't related at all. They just had the same last name. And Mary and Norma were next door neighbors, so they played together all the time. They were together constantly. So Norma was 2 years older than Mary, but mentally Norma was a little slower and she was a lot younger. And so in their friendship, Mary was the more dominant one, and Norma just kind of went along with whatever Mary said or whatever Mary was doing. They were just always together, and they would kind of lure little boys away from the other children, and accidents would happen. On May 11th, 1968, 10-year-old Mary and 12-year-old Norma Bell took a 3-year-old to get some candy. An hour later, he was found wandering around by himself and bleeding. The ambulance took care of him, but it was just ruled as an accident, and it was just an accident happened, and that was it. The very next day, the mothers of 3 young girls showed up at the police station and reported that Mary had tried to strangle one of their daughters, Pauline. And they had been playing in a sand pit, and Mary got mad at her and was strangling her. And the little girls that were with her, they said that Mary had not only strangled her, but she had also shoved sand down her throat. So the police went and asked Mary and Norma what had happened. So Mary was interviewed by the police and lectured, but nothing really happened. No juvenile charges were filed, so she didn't really get in trouble for that. Now, May 25th of 1968, just a couple weeks later, there were 2 boys playing in an abandoned house when they came across the body of Martin Brown. Now, I told you that this was a very poor neighborhood and city, so they had a lot of abandoned buildings where people just had to move away or people got evicted. So there were a lot of abandoned houses and buildings around. So the little kids that were playing outside constantly would play in these abandoned buildings. The little boy that they found was only 4 years old, and one of these boys actually knew him, and so he ran to tell his mother that he was hurt. When the mother got there, she saw a man walking out of the building with Martin in his arms. They took him to the hospital, and he was pronounced dead upon arrival. Since Martin was found alone, the police thought that the previous owners had left some medicine behind, and Martin thought that they were candies, and he took them or ate them, and then he overdosed. Or they thought that someone had helped Martin get up there, and because he had been known for being afraid of heights, he looked down and saw how high up he was, and he died from shock. So the police found a bottle of tablets nearby, which is what supported the first theory, Martin thinking that it was candy, but they did not release that to the public, and that is important later on. So the post-mortem pathologist actually ruled the cause of death as a natural one, and this kid was only 4. So it was just a really weird case. Mary and Norma, back at the scene, they had followed the little boys in that discovered Martin, and whenever the police got there, they had to usher them out. It's a little suspicious if you ask me. On May 26th, 1968, Mary was playing over at Norma's house, and Norma's dad witnessed Mary choking his daughter, pulled her off of her, slapped her and told her to go home, but he didn't really think much of it other than that. He just thought that they were playing really rough, and I mean, obviously he got upset and then just sent Mary home, but other than that, nothing really happened. The next day, May 27th, police got a call from someone reporting a break-in at a local preschool. So when the police got there, nothing was stolen, so whoever broke in wasn't interested and taking anything, but the police did find 4 different notes. And one of the notes said, "I murder so I may come back." 2 of the notes were pretty rambly and scrambled and a lot harder to understand or read. But the 4th note clearly said, "We did murder Martin Brown. F off, you bastard." Because the notes were in like a little kid handwriting, they didn't really take it that seriously. They just thought that it was a dark prank that someone was playing on the preschool. Just a few days later, on May 31st, the newly put in alarm at the preschool had been triggered, and whenever the police got there, Mary and Norma were loitering outside. And when the police asked them if they knew anything about a note being left, they lied and said that they had no idea who left it, and then they were released. So Martin's aunt knew Mary, and she had watched Mary and Norma a couple of times, and his aunt said that she got a really weird feeling from the little girls. And Martin's mother, June, actually saw the girls quite a few times, and one day Mary came up to June's door and asked to see Martin. Now, June told Mary that he was dead, and Mary said, "Oh, I know, I wanted to see him in his coffin." At school, she wrote an entry about Martin, and in her entry, she said, "There were crowds of people outside an old house. I asked what was the matter. There has been a boy who had just laid down and died." And then under this entry, she drew a picture of Martin and a man discovering him, but she also drew a picture of a little bottle of tablets. The teachers didn't check their journals every single day, so it took a while for anyone to know that this existed. Just know that the police hadn't released the fact that there were tablets, so the only people who would know about it were the ones that were there. On July 31st of 1968, Mary, Norma, and a bunch of the neighborhood kids all gathered to watch the abandoned buildings be torn down. After finding the body in one of the abandoned buildings, the police and the people of the city didn't want that to happen again. Whatever incident happened, they didn't know for sure, but they just didn't want to take the risk of anything like that happening again, so they were tearing all of these buildings down. And after this is when Mary and Norma started playing with 3-year-old Brian Howe. They led him away from people, and some people said that they lured him into a field, but some people said that it was just a vacant lot and no one was around, so I'm not sure exactly where they lured him, but shortly after he was reported missing. And this got the whole town involved. Everyone came together to find this little boy, as they should. The police were forming search parties and everyone in the town was out looking for Brian. Now, Mary and Norma, this part really creeps me out because they were specifically helping Brian's mother, and the whole time they were searching, supposedly they were skipping and singing songs and just being happy little kids, and they were completely unbothered, as if they hadn't just killed him, basically. Now, Brian had an older sister, and Mary told his sister, she said, maybe he's playing over there in that area. And when his sister went over there, she ended up finding his body. He was in a vacant lot, and he was found dead. His hair had been chopped off in certain areas and just thrown around his body. He had cuts in his legs. It was clear that he had been strangled, and the police found what looked like an M carved onto his stomach. They also found a razor blade and scissors at the scene. So when the post-mortem pathologist looked at Brian's body, he saw that there was evidence of strangulation, but he said that it wasn't like full force all at once. He said that it was like someone had put gradual pressure on his throat until he ran out of air and died. And a lot of the cuts weren't very deep, and so the doctor kind of came to the conclusion that whoever did this was either someone that was really, really weak or a child did it. This made police look into all of the neighborhood children. And so they questioned a lot of children, trying to see if anyone knew anything. And this actually made them reopen Martin's death, the first little boy who had died in the abandoned building. And the police came to the conclusion that the two deaths were related and that a child had committed both murders. Now, Mary really stuck out to the police because she attended like any conference that was held over these murders. Mary was there front and center. She was very involved in this case. Not that she was like trying to help solve it, but she was there observing like anything that was going on during, or anything that happened that had to do with this case. She was there and she was listening. Now, the police had gotten a lot of complaints about Mary Bell. They had parents coming to them and saying that their kids heard Mary brag about choking a little boy, and just the fact that Mary was so mean to her classmates, it really raised a lot of red flags to the police. So they really started to keep an eye on her. Also, remember the M that I said was carved into little Brian's belly? The post-mortem pathologist came to the conclusion that it looked like someone had put an N in the belly, and then later on someone came and added the last line to make it look like an M. The first strokes were a lot older and the last stroke was a lot newer of a cut. So after all of this, the police went to Mary's house. They just wanted to ask her some questions, but her dad, Billy Bell, was there and he did not want the police seeing Mary at all, and he threatened to release his dog on them if they ever came back. So they kind of had to leave that one alone because she's only 11 years old at this point. So I feel like because she's so young, the parents can kind of protect her in that way to a certain point. A little boy actually came forward and confessed to being a witness to Martin's murder. But this little boy was 9 years old, but he was mentally 4 years old. So he didn't realize the severity of what was going on when he was witnessing the crime until he told his parents about it. And then his parents were like, oh my God, God, you saw what happened, we're going to the police. And what this little boy said he saw was that the little boy had a sore throat, and Mary said that she could fix his sore throat by massaging it. So she started massaging his throat, and then that's what led to her slowly strangling him. Police detained Mary and Norma, and they sent them to a place where they could be questioned during the evening they would be cared for, but they just weren't allowed to go home, because if they went home, they could talk to each other or influence each other, or someone could influence their story. They just didn't want them to be talked to or in any way, because that would corrupt evidence. They were kept kind of away from home while the police were questioning them. The police started to compare Mary and Nora's handwriting to the notes that were left at the preschool. And whenever they compared the notes, they saw that Mary's handwriting was pretty similar to what was on the note. And also, remember I told you that Mary drew this picture in her journal? Well, the police saw this picture and they saw that she had drawn a picture of a little bottle labeled tablets. There's no way that she could have known about that, because they hadn't released it to the public unless she was there. August 8th of 1968, Mary and Norma Bell were charged with the murder of Martin and Brian. Now, with Brian's case, Mary said that she saw an older boy abusing Brian, and that is how he died. But then Norma ended up breaking down and she told the police that Mary had killed the boys. Norma ended up being acquitted because she was simple-minded, and the police believed that Mary just had the manipulative capability of getting Norma to be involved, to kind of get her to do whatever Mary was doing. So Mary was very manipulative, and she got Norma to do things that she wouldn't normally do. In December of 1968 is when the actual trial started, and they lasted 9 days. Throughout this whole time, Mary had shown absolutely no remorse whatsoever when it came to the little boys and what she had done, and she hadn't shown any emotion whatsoever. Until one day, the police knew that she had strangled a pigeon, and they asked Mary about it, seeing what she would say, because they had evidence and they knew that she had. And Mary just broke down and started crying, and she was so hysterical that they had to pause the trial. So all of this time, Mary was showing like absolutely no emotion, and then all of a sudden, she was showing so much emotion that it was just completely over the top. And she was examined by several psychiatrists, and all of them had come to the conclusion that she was displaying classic signs of psychopathy. I don't know if that's how you pronounce that word, but basically they said that she was a psychopath. She did admit to leaving notes at the daycare, but she said that she did it for a giggle. So Norma was acquitted, and they said that she was basically just a witness. But as for Mary, she was found guilty of 2 accounts of manslaughter. So the jury just kind of took the lead of the psychiatrist who had said that she was mentally insane, and so that's why she was guilty of 2 accounts of manslaughter, on the grounds of diminished responsibility or being medically insane. Now, remember, at this time she's only 11 years old, so she was too young to be sentenced under the Mental Health Act. So she was sent to Red Bank Secure Unit in St. Helens, and I believe it's pronounced Lancashire. And this was like a young offenders institution. And Mary's mother, Betty, visited her pretty often. So this was just a place where like young juvenile delinquents, I guess, would go when they needed to like be under supervision and when they needed like rehabilitation pretty much. So Mary's mother, Betty, visited her quite often, which is surprising given how she wanted absolutely nothing to do with her daughter. The judge described her as dangerous and said she posed a very grave risk to other children. And the psychiatrist described her as intelligent, manipulative, and dangerous. So when Mary's mother would visit her, Mary told her every time that she needed to go and tell them how she had raised her and how bad she had treated her when she was younger. And Mary really thought that if people knew what kind of a terrible childhood she had, that she would be released and they would take her mother into custody instead. Because in her mind, the reason she did all of these things was because of her childhood. So basically because her mother. So she blamed everything on her mother and none of it was her fault. So she really played the my childhood was traumatic and that's why I did these things card a lot. Now her mother, Betty, sold several stories to the press. She gave the press writings and said that they were Mary's. So we don't really know if the writings she gave the press were real or not, or if she was just giving them things to make money because they would buy stories and they would buy things from her. So after about a year, Mary was moved to Moore Court, which was an open prison. And an open prison was basically somewhere where if the person had a job, like during the day, they could go out into the world and do their job, but then at night they had to go back to the prison and sleep there. There was also like a list of things that they couldn't partake in, and it was just kind of like a strict lifestyle, but it was a little bit better than just being in prison all day every day. So in September of 1977, Mary and another inmate ended up escaping this open prison, which let's be honest, it's not gonna be hard escaping from that place. Like all you have to do is just not go back. But they were found only 3 days later, so they weren't gone for very long. But while they were gone, they met two boys, and Mary was back on headlines. Everyone knew about her case, and then all of a sudden she was back on the headlines more than a year later because her and the inmate that she had escaped with met two boys, and Mary was very detailed and she would tell everyone the story about how they met these two boys and how she lost her virginity and basically what a wild time she had during the 3 days that she had escaped. So this kind of made her story pick back up again. And she had also lived in a girls' remand home at Cumberlow Lodge in South Norwood. So she had moved to quite a few different places. And after 12 years of serving time in the year 1980 at the age 23, she was released from Askham Grange, another open prison. She was granted anonymity. She was granted anonymity. That's like a weird word. Every time I say that word, anonymity, I think of on Finding Nemo when he can't say anemone. Is that what they live in? Can't say that they live in anonymity. Anemone.
You live in what kind of home?
Anemone.
So, you know, have patience with me on that word because now I have no idea how to say it because I've said anemone so many times now. So a lot of people like to use this case as an example of like prison reform and how prison does actually work to change a person. And I do believe it does, but whenever it comes to like child psychopaths, I don't know. Because if someone so young is capable of something so terrible, I don't trust them. but I also have trust issues, so that's just me. I do believe in prison reform, and in this case, I guess I do believe in prison reform because 4 years later, Mary gave birth to a little girl, and she actually gave birth to her baby on the anniversary of Martin Brown's death, which I thought was a pretty interesting fact. But when Mary gave birth to her daughter was also granted anonymity until she reached the age of 18. Mary ended up having to go to court for her daughter because when her daughter was just 14, they were discovered by reporters at their house and they had to leave with bed sheets over their head. And of course, this obviously enraged Mary because they were supposed to be kept anonymous. Mary had gotten a chance to change her name. We don't know what she changed her name to because again, she had anonymity. So obviously when reporters found her at her house and bothered her, then she took it to court and she won in court because her daughter was 14 and her daughter hadn't reached the age 18 yet. And she actually got her daughter's anonymity stretched so that she could have it for life and she never had to worry about people knowing that she was Mary Bell's daughter. Because it could be very dangerous for some people because some people might want revenge or something. So when Mary won this case, it was called the Mary Bell Order. And she won that case May 21st of the year 2003. In the year 2009, at the age of 51, Mary Bell became a grandmother. Now, I don't know about you, but I wouldn't want her as my grandma, just saying. I mean, I'm proud of her for growing, but like, I don't know. Still don't trust people. Now, a lot of people got upset again because an author was writing a book called Cries Unheard. And this author paid Mary Bell to, you know, give them the inside scoop on everything that happened and everything that went on in her life. This made a lot of people upset because at the end of the day, she basically got paid $50,000 to kill these two little boys. I mean, she only served 12 years and then other than that, not much happened to her. And the book was about her traumatic childhood, so it made a lot of people feel sorry for her and it angered a lot of people. It was a really controversial book. So let me know down below what your thoughts are on Mary Flora Bell. Do you feel sorry for her? Do you think that what she did was justified? Or do you think that even though people go through bad things, it doesn't justify the bad things that they do? Which is what I more lean towards, but you know what? Everyone has their own opinion. If you have anything to add to this case, feel free to comment it down below. My camera battery is about to die, so I'm gonna go really fast. Don't forget to give this video a thumbs up because I like it when you like it. And also hit the button down below, subscribe, become a part of this family. Stick around if you like serial killers or if you like this kind of topic and you also like makeup so you can hang out with me while I talk about these things. And don't forget to follow me on all of my social medias. It is just Shelly G MUA on Instagram, Twitter, and TikTok. And I think that is all that I have for you. Also, this case was brought to you by my friend Keisha. She's the one that brought it up to me. And that is how I found this case. So shout out to my friend Keisha. Yeah. Anyways, I will see you all next week for another episode of Freaky Friday. God bless. Love you. Bye.